Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for our 19th episode of Ask Me Anything with Zen Garcia. I'm your host, Joy Garcia, with Sacred Word Publishing. And we're so excited to be here with you, Zen. Are you still there?
I am. Always a pleasure to be here with both of you and the rest of the listening audience.
Yes, and by both of you, he means his son, Justin Garcia, who's helping us out on the technical side on the AMA chat. So if you get confused as to why Zen is talking over the live feed, but also chatting with you, it's because it's actually either Justin or I. So let's get started with prayer. So Father, we thank you so much for bringing all of us here once again together to get our questions answered. And we ask that you would use Zen tonight, that you would speak through him, and that you would give him your wisdom, Father. We thank you so much for your love. And this time, in Yahushua's name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, so first question is from Christina. What are your thoughts about the quote-unquote bad god that goes by many names like Sakla and Yaldabaoth being the creator of the physical world and is keeping us somewhat hostage here? Sophia creates the little G god, and this story goes that he was cast here to this realm and he created us. The Nag Hammadi seems to state this. It kind of resonates with me that this world is so messed up with injustice, suffering, and this bad, quote-unquote, bad god loves to see us suffer.
Yeah, well, this is a really loaded question because there's so much to it. And what I recommend people that have studied the Nag Hammadi codices in great detail and that do understand the story of Sophia, which the story of Sophia means wisdom, and it's the Greek translation for wisdom. And so what that the story is conveying is Sophia, the Holy Spirit, stepping down, coming down from the high heavens and creating and bringing the visible worlds into being. But all of that was done on purpose, because if you read the what is even before the actual fall of Sophia, what is cited in the Nag Hammadi codices as the fall of Sophia, you have the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit counseling and speaking about discussing the creation of humanity. And in that discussion, it had come up that humanity would fall from grace and fall into sin. And because of that, they would also be cast out of paradise because, you know, God knows the end from the beginning. So they knew that Lucifer would rebel, that he would take revenge against Christ by causing the downfall of humanity and they're being cast out of the heavens. And so all this was known and all this was foreseen by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But Christ, he said that he would enter into the flesh, the Son of God. He said he would come to redeem us and that he would enter into the flesh himself in order to rectify the fall. And so the whole reason and purpose and as far as the establishment of the lower visible worlds was set in motion. And so Sophia, according to the Nag Hammadi codices, had descended, and it wasn't Yaldabaoth, the demiurge, who is Satan, Saklas, the blind god, the viper of God that created everything. He was actually allowed to take authority over what are the visible worlds. That Sophia right now is set, because even in the Jewish scriptures it says that the Shekinah of God, which is the Holy Spirit, had once been in the heavens but is now here on the earth with man. And so she descended willingly from the heavens to be here and to tabernacle with humanity and to walk us through what is our fallen state of being and our being kind of caught up in this fallen world. And Christ also descended, but also, you know, he ascended after the resurrection, but will come again. And so this is the whole kind of story. You have to understand the beginning and then how the Nag Hammadi codices play into the story to understand where we are now. And so the lower visible worlds were created, and then the demiurge, Samael, he kind of counterfeited and created and manipulated and altered what is the fabric of creation to suit his own needs and to create his own kingdom to rule here on the earth. And he is over the archons, which are legion. And so they are the demonic forces which are warring against the angelic hierarchy, the Most High's angels, for the souls of humanity. And our earth and our world and this realm, being in the visible, you know, we're in the visible bandwidth, which is a lower vibration, that the ethereal, the heavenly heavens, are light, pure light. But we are in a realm where light has condensed into material form. And what we see and experience is physical. This world is largely a physical construct, but at its core, at its atomic level, it still is light. And Christ is the light of the world. He is the source from which all things were created. And that's why the Godhead. And so that's why we see that it is said that Christ is within, that the kingdom is within, because all of creation exists as part of the fabric of what is the reality of the Godhead, that they expanded to become everything. And so within everything is the sacred connecting link to source and, you know, what is God. And so reading the Nag Hammadi codices, and especially if you've not read the Pista Sophia, it describes how the Holy Spirit, again, came willingly down here to the earth and created the visible realms. And then bringing the demiurge into being, which is Satan, Yaldabaoth, called Saklas, and Samael. Samael meaning the viper of God, the angel of death. Saklas meaning the blind fool or the blind god. And so all of these are names for, you know, even though they teach, the so-called Gnostic experts teach that that the God of the Old Testament is Satan, that Yahweh is Satan, that's absolutely incorrect. Yahweh or Yahweh, Yahuwah, the Father, was part of the original Godhead, the pre-existent, self-eternal Godhead that is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They pre-existed before anything else came into being. And then the lower visible worlds were created, and it would be here on the earth, which is a meeting place for the duality of good and evil, that the war for the souls of humanity would take place, and that it would be in the physical flesh bodies, in our mortal being, that humans would incarnate in order to experience both good and evil, the knowledge of good and evil. And so also what you'll read in the Nag Hammadi codices is humanity eating from the tree of the good, which you have to understand that there's two stories, and they have to do with what is cited in the Nag Hammadi codices as the three Adams. The first Adam being Christ, the second Adam being the sixth day Adam that was created in paradise and that fell and was banished exiled from the heavens to the earth. And then the third Adam is the eighth day, the mortal Adam, which being banished from heaven, found himself recreated into flesh form. And it was this Adam that occupies the body and that became the ancestor of modern humanity. The story is quite complex and very difficult to understand, but for those that want to know more about and are interested in how to interpret the Nag Hammadi codices and the timeline that is described within them, I have deciphered and put all of them into a cohesive narrative and have explained that narrative and how it fits in with what the is cited in the Bible. And you can find that in my sixth book, Sons of God, Who We Are, Why We Are Here. And we have reprinted that book and made it available to everybody. I know that at one point it was selling for like $500 a copy because it was out of print. But you can find both Sons of God and Skyfall now in second edition. And the Sons of God goes into great detail as to the story that you're asking about with the fall of Sophia and the creation of Yaldabaoth the Demiurge.
Thank you. Next question. I think you've answered a couple times, but maybe you can comment shortly. The King James, on the King James, what if it was corrupted from what the original texts were supposed to relay? There's even talk that Shakespeare and some other Illuminati were involved in the writing of it. The Catholic Church, too. What are your thoughts?
Well, I know for without a doubt that it has been altered and changed and that certain things have been left out, especially allusion to the word of the Lord, which is Christ in the relationship of Israel and the early patriarchs. All of that has been removed. And even the name of the Father and the Son have also been removed. And the, you know, even the original Apocrypha, which was included in the King James, has also now been removed. And so there are a lot of things that are not exactly correct with the King James. But I do know the King James version of the Bible to be inspired and prophetically accurate, and that God did preserve it in the form that has reached us now. And so even though the powers that be have altered it, have changed it, and have removed certain aspect, which is why people need to go back and study the older sources like the Aramaic Targum for greater understanding and greater detail on what has been removed. Still, as I said, it is prophetic and it holds the inspiration of God within it. And so there are two other sources which I can cite as to confirmation of this premise. And one is my friend Bill McGregor's work on the tuning fork and how he has found that the 66 books of the book of, I mean, the 66 chapters of the book of Isaiah, that each one of those chapters fits and is connected to and reveals in similarity as the 66 books of the King James version of the Bible. The 37 books of the Old Testament and the 29 of the New Testament. And so that is absolute confirmation as to the divinely inspired nature of the King James version of the Bible, as well as the work of Ivan Panin, who was a atheistic Russian communist mathematician who, looking at and examining the Bible, found a mathematical code and formula which is not located or found or can be discovered in any other book in the entirety of the world, that this mathematical code, which you can go to his work for clarity on what I am speaking about, but he also confirms without a doubt that the King James Version of the Bible is absolutely inspired. And so, even though I know that there are aspects of it that have absolutely been corrupted, yet the inspiration of God is still found in and his hands and are all upon it. And that, as it says in 2 Peter, that the prophets were led by the Holy Spirit in inspiration to write what they wrote, and also for it to be gathered together in the manner that it is in present form. And so, but again, for those that want to know more about what has been tainted and become ambiguous within the canonical materials, like the story of Christ, how there's, you know, only one story of his early childhood, that these kind of things can be gleaned from the extra-biblical manuscripts, and that specifically with the translations and how some things have been lost in translation, coming and being transcribed from the Hebrew into the Aramaic, and the Aramaic into the Greek, and the Greek into the English, then, or even into the Latin, that one has to study, in my opinion, the older translations, and that the first and most original translation of the Hebrew Torah is the Aramaic and the Palestinian Targum. And in reading and studying those scriptures, so much more information comes to light, and so much more detail becomes available to help you to understand the canon as we have it. And it just so happens that we spent, I think, 40 weeks going through the Aramaic Targum chapter by chapter, verse by verse, through the book of Genesis, all the way through Exodus, until we got to the Old Testament law. And you can find all of that available on our weekly Aramaic Targum study. There's a playlist on both of our YouTube channels, Endeavor Freedom and Zen Garcia, and you can listen to each one of those chapters. And as we, you know, we did like two chapters every week, or we tried to at least, but you can read through or listen to that information, and you can also glean from that work all of the other extra-biblical manuscripts which cite and also confirm the revelations that are found there within the Targum. And then you can follow along with your King James and see how much the story varies and how much has been left out. And in doing so, I guarantee you, you will have a better understanding of the scriptures, and you will understand what has been removed and left out of it more so than 90% of the mainstream pastors, preachers, ministers, and teachers that most people go to as an authority for, you know, interpreting the Bible and the scriptures.
Thank you. Next question is from Edward. Zen did a show on the order of creation. He mentioned Solomon having authority over all animals and demons. In addition, Solomon could communicate with the animals. I believe Zen said this was in a secret text. Does Zen cover these texts in any of his books? And if so, which one?
Yes, I do. One of the books that we put together some of this information is in the Testaments of the Patriarchs and the Prophets. and not my the books as far as the 21 that I wrote where I share commentary and I break down all of the different scriptures. But no, I have not covered this particular story in great detail. But if you are interested in it, you can find the Testament of Solomon and all the other testaments of the prophets, the patriarchs, and some of the apostles found in the, as I said, the Testament of the Patriarchs and the Prophets, which it's like a 400-plus page book and contains numerous extra-biblical accounts and texts most people have never heard about and never had a chance to read. But also, there's a book based on, again, extra-biblical accounts, very ancient sources that not a lot of people are familiar with and that tell the story of Solomon having the authority of over the, you know, the creatures, and also over the demons. And you can find that in a book called As It Came to Pass. And it's a story, it's an extra-biblical account of the stories of David and Solomon, the folklore surrounding David and Solomon, and also how Solomon had a flying carpet. All kind of very interesting stories. Even David's war against the giants. There's even mentioned in this particular book, as I brought it out in broadcast, the name of the one brother of Goliath, which is not mentioned in the canon, that there are the names of three of his giant brothers, but in this book it mentions Yishbi as the other giant, which in this case, Benaiah, one of the soldiers and protectors of David, that he killed him. And so you can know about and learn about all of these stories. As I said in this book, it's called As It Came to Pass, I believe is what it is. I'll look it up and post a link in the chat. But yeah, that is the one you would want to. And it's incredibly moving and very deeply moving, beautiful stories, very short, but gives you really incredible insight into the stories, the lost stories of David and Solomon.
Thank you. Next question is from Derek. When Enoch was shown the inner workings of the sun, moon, etc., was this before the purge of the fallen in physical form by the Most High's wrath? If so, could this be why the mystery of what the planets, parentheses, planets is the word they use anyway, really are is a constant debate, with the connection to ancient gods and mythology interwoven into the planet's sand, their names, and the mention of the punishment of some of the fallen in Enoch, wandering stars? Could one maybe say that possibly the reason the planets aren't mentioned anywhere could be because that the visual we do have was seen before certain events?
I didn't understand any of that.
I'm sorry. Really either. I figured maybe you would. I'm not sure how to shorten that question.
I can read the first part again.
When Enoch was shown the inner workings of the sun, moon, etc., was this before the purge of the fallen in physical form by the Most High's wrath? Maybe we could start with that question.
Okay. The purge of the fallen before the physical wrath of God, is that what it said?
When Enoch was shown the inner workings of the sun, moon, etc., was this before the purge of the fallen in physical form by the Most High's wrath?
Okay. Um, Wait a second. All right, read the first part again, because I'm trying to get a grasp of the question
so I can
answer it correctly.
Okay, when Enoch was shown the inner workings of the sun, moon, etc., was this before the purge of the fallen in physical form by the Most High's wrath?
No.
Okay.
And this is also mentioned in the Book of Enoch as well, in the second Book of Enoch, the Book of the Secrets of Enoch, chapter 29 and 30. You see there that the Lucifer and the rebellion of the fallen angels against Christ and the Most High occurred on the second day, and they were cast out of the heavens. Enoch was not shown the vision of the luminaries, of course, until he was born. And so this was way after even the sixth day creation of modern humanity. So it was a long time after. The fallen angels were cast out of the heavens way before the modern creation of humanity. So let's go to the next part of the question.
Alrighty. Next part. If so, could this be why the mystery of what the planets really are is a constant debate? Should we stop at that? Because there's more.
Yeah, the planets are the planets as far as the wandering stars. They are not Lucifer and the rebel angels. These are the seven, you know, the seven planets that were supposed to hold. They were supposed to hold circuit in what is the tabernacle of the heaven, and the lower part of what is the firmament, the space between God's throne and the earth, is divided into seven heavens. And in these seven heavens, each one of these stars, these wandering planets, were supposed to hold circuit. Well, the first seven wandering stars that had and that were originally given that circuit and were supposed to hold it, they refused to come about at the appointed time. And because of that, they were removed from their place in the heavens, and they were banished to outer darkness. And Enoch describes this in chapter 15 or 18, I believe, where he describes the outer rim of the earth where the firmament joins the land, and he speaks about a place where in the north where there's no firmament above it, and this is where the abysmal chasm is, which is the center of the earth, right where the North Pole is, right below Polaris. And that the reason there's no firmament above it is because this is the portal. There's a portal that leads to the heavenly throne, and also an opening called the bottomless pit, which leads down into the interior of the earth. And it is the gateway to Sheol, down into the center of the earth. And so those wandering stars are not the fallen angels. They are not Lucifer and the one-third of the angels of the Most High, which joined him in rebellion. Because when the firmament was put into place on the second day, which the fall of the rebel angels occurred even before the establishment of the firmament, and it's what led to the war in heaven, that led to the destruction of the earth, and that led to the recreation of it, as we see in Genesis chapter 1, verses 2 onwards. And so the celestials that became the wandering stars and the sun and the moon, they were created on the fourth day after the fall of the rebel angels, after the war in heaven, and after the construction of the firmament. And they were placed into the tabernacle of the firmament on the fourth day. So something completely different. And these celestials are part of the angels. You know, all the stars are angels. They are celestial entities. And so, and the sun, it says in the book of Enoch, is lit by the bright and light of 1,000 angels. And so, next part.
All right, next part. With the connection to ancient gods and mythology interwoven into the planet sand, their names and the mention of the punishment of some of the fallen in Enoch, could one maybe say that possibly the reason the planets aren't mentioned anywhere is because the visual we do have was seen before certain events?
The visual we do have was seen before. I don't understand that part of the question, but I'll just answer as best I can. Okay. With regard to the connections of the planets with the ancient gods. The Greeks and the Romans, they revered the celestials and they revered the luminaries for whatever reason, but they attributed those luminaries with being what we see and what we've come to know as the fallen ones, the rebel angels. That Lucifer, you know, he is the bright and morning star, which is connected to Venus. And also, he claims to be, you know, the sun. Lucifer is equated with the sun god and also the worship of the sun, and also to the heliocentric Copernican model for understanding world, which is also connected to the coming reign of the Antichrist. And so, however Satan decided to swing it long ago, he did have the ancient cultures and peoples revering the luminaries as the pantheon of gods and goddesses. And those luminaries were connected to, I believe, the predominant deities and the angels which joined him in rebellion and that were cast down and cast out long ago, because they do hold physical form. And as the mythology said, they did take wives of all which they chose. They were involved in the raping of earth women and the birth of these hybrid heroes, giants, and men of renown. And so that's how the story connects to what is cited in the Bible in Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Because, you know, again, the sons of God that mated with the daughters of man, it was Lucifer that initially mated with Eve and created Cain. And it was through Cain that the children of the devil, the sons of darkness, the sons of Belial, came into being. And it's these individuals and this race, our half cousins, that we are at war with, and we don't even understand, because, you know, most people don't know that there is a seed of the serpent here upon the earth, and that they have been since long ago waging war against humanity and the children of Adam. And we see that Christ speaks about this in Matthew chapter 13 as the parable of the kingdom, the sower, and the wheat, the tares of the field. And also in chapter 25 as the goat and the sheep. And we see that Yahweh speaks about this in Isaiah chapter 14, where he speaks of Lucifer as the abominable branch. The abominable branch because his bloodline makes up half of the family tree of humanity. And his children are called the seed of the evildoers. And it says in those chapters, prepare slaughter for his children, that they do not inherit the earth, nor, you know, build up these fantastic cities. And so God speaks about warring against the children of the devil in the same way that Christ does when he says, allow both to grow together until the time of the end. And then at the end, he would send forth the angels as reapers to gather the tares for burning, but the wheat for preservation. And so that's the best way I can answer that.
Thank you. Next question is from Callie Jim. I just listened to a message and Zen mentioned something about the 3,000-year reign. Is that to say that there has already been others, or did I misunderstand?
3,000-year reign? No. I'm assuming that they misunderstood. There's only 1,000-year millennial reign, and it happens after the 6,000 years of the Second World Age. This particular Second World Age is divided into 7,000 years, 1,000 years for each day of the creation. It says in 2 Peter that with God, a day is as 1,000 years. And that's prophetically accurate because God has established the timeline for the Second World Age to occur 120 jubilees equaling times 50 equals 6,000 years or thereabout. And then we have 1,000 years added to this timeline for 7,000 years, and that is the millennial reign. And Christ comes again at the end of the 6,000 years, and then the harvest, the separation of the wheat and the tares again, the goat and the sheep, the righteous from the wicked, and then those that are numbered and worthy and counted amongst the elect, they will then enter after the great white throne judgment into paradise, which is New Jerusalem, which will descend out of the heavens and be brought here to the earth, and that Christ and God and the Holy Spirit will reign with us in New Jerusalem here upon the earth. And then after that 1,000 years, Satan will be loose for little season and will go forth to tempt the nations once more. And then after that temptation, then there will be what is called in the book of Enoch as the eighth day. It's an eternal age where there will no longer be good and evil and the duality of it, for the former things will have been swept away. At that time, the second death will come about, and in my opinion, and some people, you know, believe otherwise, but I believe at that time that the devil and Satan and the fallen angels and those that are evil amongst humanity, they will be annihilated as if they had never been. And that will be what is called in scripture the second death.
Thank you. Next question is from Marilyn. Was Jesus a Jew?
There's you know, Jew is not even a proper word. That the original word is Judean, and it means of the tribe of Judah. And yes, he is of the tribe of Judah. That is scripturally accurate. Jew is something completely different. It's a term that has been now used and associated with the tribe of Judah, and that Judah and Benjamin were separated from the other 10 tribes, and that they were the only ones that had survived. All the others were scattered when they were taken into exile. And it is the Jewish people that are now in control of Israel in the Holy Land. But, you know, again, before and during Christ's time, there was no Jew or word for Jew. It was the Judeans. And that, you know, again, but both are associated to the tribe of Judah. And so that's the distinction. And so, you know, that's the differentiation in my opinion.
Thank you. Next question is, let's see, from Paul. Did dinosaurs really exist, or are they another deception?
Well, depends on how you approach this. Did creatures that were monstrous and that, you know, we can't understand, that were maybe a very much larger size and stature, exist in ancient times? Absolutely. Dragons existed in ancient times. Basilisks, the cockatrice, these kind of reptilian beings absolutely existed in ancient times. They're cited in scripture as having existed. Even the behemoth, which, you know, had a tail the size of a cedar tree, which is absolutely huge. Leviathan, these kind of creatures existed and are scriptural. Does that mean that the dinosaurs, in the way that science tells us, existed, that they existed millions of billions of years ago? And I personally believe that, you know, dinosaurs walked with man, that there are places where you have dinosaur tracks and also, you know, hominid footprints. And so, in even the Ica stones, which are a very ancient, you know, stones that have pictographic images of them, of even humans riding upon dinosaur-like creatures. And so I absolutely believe they existed. Was it before humanity and very ancient past? I don't know. The depictions on the Ica stones say differently. And so even the tracks that were found where, you know, human and these dinosaur prints are found in the same bedrock. And so what we've been told by science, I believe a lot of that is fabrication. Even with, you know, the cosmology, the Copernican heliocentric model for understanding world, and the whole Darwinian that we evolved the monkeys, evolution, that's a complete lie. And so one has to be very careful with what one believes of and accepts from science, because I've learned especially since 2015, when I came to understand biblical cosmology and I was able to interpret correctly the book of Enoch, the book on the courses of the heavenly luminaries, and to bring that secret forth to humanity, that we cannot trust NASA and science, and that largely what we have been indoctrinated into, as far as that the Earth is a planet, one of nine spinning in orbit around the sun, that the sun is at the center of our so-called solar system, and that all the stars in the sky are suns and all have planetary systems in orbit around them, all of that is absolute fabrication. The whole evolutionary that we evolved in monkeys, all that is fabrication. And so one must be very careful with what they believe of what is said, you know, and declared by science. Because it is a faith. It is a religion.
Thank you. Next question. Please, can Zen discuss the discrepancy of time, being it was 5,500 years when Yeshua died and went down into Sheol to keep a promise to Adam? What's confusing is it doesn't make sense now, because it means his return should have been 1,500 years later. We are 500 years overdue.
Oh, goodness. This is something that both W. Kent Smith and S. Douglas and Woodward and I have been doing shows about. And I really can't help you to understand the timeline and how all that breaks down and how it was fulfilled and how it was changed, because these things are still new in consideration to me. And even the timeline and the history of the Tartarian Empire and how all that has changed, and how history you know, some aspects of it have been made up, some additional years added, some subtracted. I can't really tell you what is right and what isn't. I do know that without a doubt that there is on the books, as I describe in great detail in the ancient prophecies of Christ, the 5,500-year timeline for Adam, that Christ told Adam, I will come to save you 5,500 years, and I will take on mortal flesh myself, be born of a virgin. At that time, and after banishing him from paradise. And so, yes, that is prophetically accurate. And yes, there are numerous breakdowns which confirm that biblical prophecy and the timeline and the narrative of it. Now, traditionally, we have all been taught and we all have believed that there was 2,000 years from Adam to Abraham, and from Abraham to Christ, and 2,000 years from Christ to where we are now, which is 6,000 years. And so how, you know, how the years have been distorted, how the years have, what's been added and what's been subtracted, I don't know. And I'm just the, you know, I'm not one that has studied in great detail all the histories and added all the dates for all of the different patriarchs and their lifelines and, you know, came up with a number. My forte and my interest has been to study the prophetic word and to study the extra biblical manuscripts, all that has been available to us. And all of that I am familiar with in great, great discernment. The Nag Hammadi Codices, the Apocrypha, the Pseudepigrapha, the Colburn Bible, all of these, I mean, all of these extra-biblical texts, whatever they may be, I've studied, I think, probably a lot more than most people have. And I know a lot about, because I've read numerous times, most of these texts. And so I'm familiar with them in a way that most are not. However, the whole thing with how history breaks down and, you know, how the dates and all that, that's not my forte and that's not my expertise. And that's really not even my interest. My interest is, the study of prophecy and the study of God's word. And so that's what I place my emphasis and my focus upon.
Doesn't Kent talk about it in his book, Forever?
Yes, Tales of Forever. Yes. Okay. And also S. Douglas Woodward talks about it in his new book because he found confirmation of that 5,500-year prophecy in the Septuagint. And so we just did a show last night, and we did one about a month ago. You can find it on our YouTube channel, The 5,500-Year Prophecy, and the newest show will be called Paradigm Shift, but it's not released yet. Give us a week, and I should have it up on YouTube. But you can find it on Truth Frequency Radio right now. It was the show I did last night with both of them on July 4th.
Awesome. And if you're interested in learning more about Tales of Forever, it's also on sacredwordpublishing.com. We also added a link to it to the chat. If you want to check it out and read the first couple of pages to get an idea, you can preview the book as well. And that's the same with all of our books. Preview. So that being said, I will move on to the next question. If you're, are you done answering that one, Zen?
Yes.
Okay. So next question is from Paul. What are your thoughts on animals? Do they also have eternal spirits? And do you believe our pets will be with us in heaven?
Absolutely. I believe that everything that has form in creation, and even those things which are unseen, that do not have physical form, that everything is a manifestation of Christ as the light of the world, and that everything in its ethereal, pure nature is what is the Godhead, that the Godhead is the only thing that pre-existed everything else. And everything else steps down in vibration to become sound frequency, and then eventually to take on form. Even the periodic table of the elements, you see that, you know, they all become denser and denser and denser from hydrogen onwards. It's the same thing that in the creation, at its purest source, at the atomic level, everything is atoms, electrons, and protons. And all of that makes up what is energy. In my opinion, that energy and the source of all that energy is the Godhead. That Christ, as the light of the world, became all things, as it says in John chapter 1. And so I believe everything is sacred and has connection to the Godhead. Even though we do find ourselves now in a fallen world, and that we live in a visible world where everything is seemingly physical, and we are learning through the experience of good and evil, still yet at its core and at its source, everything, the spirit of everything, the consciousness, the eternity, the immortal aspect of everything. And I do absolutely believe that all, especially conscious creatures, including all of the bugs that, you know, everybody hates and, you know, the will swat and kill. And I think everything is, from the micro to the macrocosm, is a reflection of God. And that when you look closely at everything, you see the unique and the incredible complexity that God designed everything with intelligence and with inspiration. The way that, you know, the bee or the hummingbird can hover in the air and fly, and the looking at the minute details of their life and their systems, their biological, the, you know, how their biological entities, that, in my opinion, is the fingerprint of the signature of God in the creation of those things. And everything from, as I said, the micro to the macro, in my opinion, shows that God had established and created all things. And because God is sacred and God is immortal and eternal, I see that reflected on every level in all of the creation, that it was established in beauty and harmony and perfection. And even though we create evil and we have the free will to create evil in this world, and that, you know, it has a very ugly and dirty side to it, when you look at the larger and the grander reasons for our being and how God established the creation, everything, in my opinion, shows the incredible intricate nature of God's hand in establishing all things. And so, yes, I believe that all of the creatures, all of the flowers, all of the trees, all of the rocks, everything as we see it here, that in the heavens, it will be reflected in similarity, that what we see here on the earth is also reflected in the heavens.
Thank you. We'll do one more question and then go into break. But again, this is from Against the Flow. What do you think of the Septuagint, particularly the Logos Bible software's translation of Henry Barclay Sweet's Septuagint? I'm seeing it used to discredit Daniel 9:27 in the midst of the week. Can you explain the scripture prophetically?
No, because I'm not familiar with it, and I'm not sure about that translation. The one I'm familiar with is the Brenton translation. And even though I've studied and read and, you know, have paralleled much of what is contained within the Septuagint with the King James and also the Targum. I'm not familiar with that particular passage, and so I can't talk about the discrepancy because I don't know anything about it. And so, you know, I don't have expertise on that, and so I can't really say.
No worries. Well, then with that, let's go into break, Sens. Rest your voice for a second, get some water, and we'll move on to announcements. Alrighty, this is actually news to you too, Zen, I think, but we have finally created a page on our website for free resources. Yay! I think there's like over 30 books or something like that on there. And it's most of the documents that Zen had on his Facebook page, and it's still over there, but now people can have easier access to them. I know a lot of our listeners don't use Facebook at all, so now you can go directly onto our website, and once you do, you'll see on the menu, you'll see just free resources. Click that and you'll be able to take a look at those resources for free. And we'll also add a link to those resources to the description on this video, as well as add it to the chat. But we are so excited to finally get this big project done. And as Zen finds more resources that he'd like to share, we'll not only add it to that Facebook page, we will also add it to the free resources page. So please keep track of that page and use it for the studying that you're doing. So there's free resources, and our second announcement, which we're very excited about, is for our Sacred Word Revealed Conference, March 27th through 29, 2020. We are bringing on a new speaker, so not only are we going to have Zen Garcia, Gary Wayne, Dr. Pigeon, the Benoons from Israeli News Live, Dr. Joy Pugh, Justin Garcia, we're also going to be inviting Jonathan Click to share the stage and to share his knowledge. And we're so excited to have him on board. So please do, if you are interested in attending the conference, please check out sacredwordrevealed.com. It's also a page on our website. If you go to sacredwordpublishing.com and just click Sacred Word Revealed 2020 in the menu, you will learn more about that. And my last announcement is about notifications on YouTube. So a lot of people have been reaching out saying that they haven't been getting notified when we have our YouTube videos go up. And I would just like to remind people, just in case, if you haven't already clicked the bell next to subscribe under our video right now, please do that. And hopefully, I know that there's probably a lot of other things going on, but just in case, please do click that again if it has been unclicked, to make sure to get those notifications. But I do see, Zen, you're back on. Do you have any comments about any of the new announcements?
Yes, I'm very excited that, you know, my friend and brother Jonathan Click will be joining us for the conference. Many of you know that he and I have been confirming witness for a lot of the esoteric concepts, which most people do not speak upon, teach, but actually condemn. And so it will be exciting to do some round tables on that information. And he's also the one that decrypted the money to show how all the currency, the American currency, has encoded on it the bombings that took place in, for instance, the Oklahoma City bombing and that of 9/11, and the bombing of the Pentagon, that it was encoded onto the currency years before it actually happened, which is, when you think about it, just absolutely mind-blowing. But I'm hoping that he will do a presentation on that as well, you know, that, you know, he's been blessed with the spiritual gift of discernment on so many other things, and so it will be interesting to, and he's not done conferences before, And I know many of you are fans, but have never had a chance to meet him. And so this will be a way for you to, you know, actually hear him in person and have a chance to meet him. And so it's going to be exciting. And along with all of the other just very gifted individuals, for all of us to be able to come together in such manner is just a huge blessing. And but I did want to make mention also of the text that I was that people had asked about. I did find it here on Amazon. It is called "And It Came to Pass: Legends and Stories About King David and King Solomon." And it's a fantastic read. It will greatly bless your life. And so do check it out.
Awesome. And really quickly, last housekeeping item. If you are going to the conference, please make sure to book your hotel room through our website, sacredwordrevealed.com. And it's just going to be so much fun for everyone to stay in the exact same place, which will also be the same place that we are holding the conference, for us to be able to fellowship further deep through the night and, you know, dig through all the rabbit holes together. But also, of course, because we do have to fill that room block, to be honest. So we'd love your support in doing that and using our link to get even discounted rooms as well, since we have gotten the rooms down to $109 per night instead of, you know, sometimes up to $200 that DoubleTree can go up to. But with that being said, I would also like to mention that we are only down to about questions of the 14, and we still have an hour left. So if you have a question, please add it to the live chat so that we can ask them through this live show. And for people who have already added questions to the chat, I've been somewhat keeping track and I do have a list going, but please add whatever other questions you may have. So with that, let's move on to your next question from Luis. In the time of Noah's flood, did Satan attempt to warn his seed about the flood? Have his people built their own ark, or did he realize that any attempt to stop it would be futile?
That's a really great question. And we do see reflection in the Sumerian mythologies of Enki, which I believe Enki is the same as Satan. And in the Egyptian mythology, he is called Ptah. And in the Roman and the Greek mythology, he is cited as Poseidon. That there's also, you know, that Zeus, who's the other supposed the brother of Enki in the Sumerian mythology. But anyways, you know, there's a pantheon of the three, which is strange, but in the same way, in the Sumerian mythology, it speaks about Enki going to an individual called Zarathustra, and he gives him knowledge of, you know, the coming flood, and he had been forced to take a vow not to reveal it to humanity, because according to the Sumerian stories, the Sumerian gods, they wanted humanity to die out. They wanted what was the Antarctic ice cap was becoming loose and was going to slip off, and in that way would cause a flood upon the world. And, you know, so the story is slightly different. We don't even know if this was the biblical flood with the 40 days of rain and, you know, how God just opened the floodgates, the windows of heaven, and also the foundations of the earth, that all the waters were allowed to flood into the plain as far as to cover over the mountaintops. But anyways, in the Sumerian mythology, Enki goes, and because he had made this vow, he speaks to a reed wall. and Zarathustra is able to overhear him, and he constructs what is said to be some kind of submarine-type vehicle. And so, you know, there could quite possibly be that which was alluded to in the question with regard to Satan going to some of his own bloodline. And it also describes that in the Sumerian mythology that the children of Cain, which in the Sumerian mythology, the mark of Cain is that they are not able to grow beards and they do not have facial hair. And so Cain was said in the Sumerian mythology to be removed to South America, which is interesting because the city Tenochtitlan, which is in Mexico, means the city of Enoch. And we know that Cain, his firstborn son, was Enoch. And there in South America, the native peoples, the indigenous peoples, are not able to grow facial hair. Which, you know, again, is interesting, but it does describe also this Sumerian mythology that Cain survived the flood in some manner, and that his children were able to survive afterwards. I mean, not Cain specifically, but the Cainites, the children of Cain, were able to survive the flood. And well, even though we know in scriptures that, you know, the children of Cain survived through Ham, and that the Canaanites were the seed of the serpent after the flood, but that specifically in South America, the children of Cain somehow had survived, and that in the Sumerian story again, you see a different account of the ark or the submarine type vehicle being created. And so who knows? Gary Wayne, he's done incredible research on the flood narrative from all the different cultures of the world. And there's another book that one can go to and study for, you know, different accounts of different peoples from all over the world, having their own flood stories, their own flood narratives, and description of different groups of people having survived in different manner. And so in examining and looking at all of those different accounts, it makes me think of that God in the Bible, that the story of the flood and the survival of the eight was specific to Israel and perhaps was not an account of, you know, if there were any other survivors in the world. Because, of course, Gary's work in the Genesis 6 conspiracy, which he covers the flood in great detail and the different stories of different people that survived, he specifically brings up the story of Sihon, who is the brother of Og. And we know that in the Bible, it says that Og was the remnant, the last remnant giant, and that he was able to survive the flood, according to the Targum, Genesis chapter 15. Og had survived by riding upon the top of the ark and being fed by Noah. But somehow, his brother Sihon, who was also a antediluvian giant, he survived the flood as well. And we don't know how, and we're not given that story in the Bible, but without a doubt, Sihon survived because he was one of the giants, and being the brother of Og, he fought against Israel when they came in to inherit the promised land. And so we don't know, you know, what people and what, you know, beings, what cultures survived the flood and how, but there does seem to be even biblical allusion to some characters having survived that are mentioned not mentioned in the story of the eight that were preserved on Noah's Ark. And so just something to consider.
Thank you. Next question is also from Luis. I've always seen myself as a truth seeker, and I've studied and believed wholeheartedly in things that eventually turned out to be false. Now I feel like a great skeptic about everything and a bit discouraged. How does one overcome this, in your opinion?
You must study to show yourself approved and be open-minded to understand that we don't know everything and that most of what we have been indoctrinated into belief is based upon a lie. And so it's smart to be skeptical of everything, and that in being a truth seeker that you go forth to study with open-mindedness and to research everything so that you can come to knowledge on what is true and what isn't. Because again, what I've learned in my research of truth is that truth is far from what we thought it to be initially before coming to knowledge on things like the New World Order conspiracy, government-sponsored tyranny, how, you know, they create the boogeyman that they use as a terrorist to then go forth and bomb other countries or to prop up dictators. I mean, the controlled opposition and the modus operandi of Satan is to control things from the top down and then to create the appearance of minority and like the false left-right paradigm of the Democratic and Republican system here in America. Both sides of that coin are controlled, and they both serve the same entities and the same corporate lobbyists and the same powers that be, which are the Satan, the the Masonic God, the Illuminati gods, that is the eye atop the Illuminati pyramid. And so the conspiracies are wide and vast and very real. And going through discernment on everything is difficult, takes many years of study, but first and foremost, it takes open-mindedness to examine things without judgment and bias. Because most people, believing they already know different and better, and that they are wise and educated, are never able to overcome their indoctrination to learn the truth of what is. And I also find that most people are comfortable and complacent. The Laodicean church, that they don't really want to know the truth or not concerned for it, just as they have no concern for the kingdom. And they really don't want to learn anything that is contrary to what they already think they know of as truth and as their reality. That they usually only will seek to confirm and to find favorable opinion for what they believe of as truth. And one has to look at and be able to examine both sides of an issue, both sides of a topic, to really then learn what is real and what isn't. And I think more than anything, that one has to pray and that one has to have close relationship with the Godhead to be led in discernment in such manner, and that it is the Holy Spirit which can open your eyes, give you the eyes to see, the ears to hear, and a mind to understand. And that if you are humble and that you go before them in prayer, that these kind of things will be given unto you, will be brought upon you. Because the Bible says, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be opened. And in my opinion, that this has been truthful for me in my experience, and that truly that is the way of it, that what is first and foremost and most important is seeking relationship with the Godhead, because they are the ones that can give you discernment on all things.
Thank you. Next question is from Rhonda. What pseudepigrapha writings, scriptures, books best mention the millennium 1,000 years, also regarding the time, times and a half?
Well, there's lots of them. Second Ezra. If you really want to know about the times and the fig tree generation, I recommend that you get the Great Commission 3. Because in that book, there are all those texts, many numerous dozens of manuscripts, which most people have never heard about, that are specific to the end of days, like the revelation of St. John the Theologian, which is different from the revelation that is the last chapter in our Bible, the last book in our Bible. If you want to know more about the millennial reign, certainly Second Esdras covers it in great detail. But there are numerous texts. The Apocalypse of Elijah, one of my most favorites. As I mentioned, the Revelation of St. John the Theologian, the Apocalypse of Thomas, the Apocalypse of Peter. There's so many of them, which most people have not read, have not studied, have not even heard about. And so, if you want all of them compiled together in one book, that's the book you want. The Great Commission 3, the End Time Apocalypses, and all of what you are seeking with regard to the end of days is contained therein.
Thank you. Next question. I hear Christians say that, quote unquote, anyone can be saved. But to me, the Bible says God predestines some and doesn't predestine others, meaning not everyone can technically be saved. So I feel it's not accurate to tell people that everyone or anyone can be saved. Can you give your opinion on this?
I don't believe at all that predestination says that some can be saved and others can't. Not at all. I believe that everybody can be saved, and that there is a free will component connected to that. And that free will component largely depends on whether one comes to know and understand Christ as Savior and Messiah, and that he being the way, the truth, and the light, that eternity and salvation are through him. But to say that some are predestined to be saved and others not, to me, that would insinuate that God is callous and that he just randomly chose some to be saved and others to be excluded and to be damned and condemned. And in my mind, that does not in any way show that God is just and righteous and merciful. And that, in my opinion, shows that there's a callousness and a favoritism, which, like, if you don't understand how election connects to Jacob being favored and Esau hated, and that there's a free will component connected to that as well, it wouldn't make sense to you. But I don't at all believe that some are predestined to be saved, and no matter what they do, that, you know, that's just the way it's going to be. And that those that are condemned and have no part in salvation, that no matter what they do, that there's no chance. That doesn't make at all any kind of sense to me. In my opinion, God allows us, gives us through love, the free will to choose and to decide whether we want to choose Satan or Christ as, you know, to serve one or two masters. And the those that don't choose, they are counted as lukewarm and spewed out and numbered with those that are condemned, which even though the electus view, absolutely, I believe that free will is the major determining factor for whether one will ally and realign in allegiance with Christ during this lifetime. And in fact, that was the purpose of our coming into the flesh, in my opinion. And so I don't at all agree with this individual and, you know, his stance on that no matter what somebody does, some are going to be saved and others excluded from that salvation. That doesn't make at all any sense to me.
Amen. Thank you. Next question. We are now moving into live question chat. Is from Raul Garcia. Do you have any information on Black Sun?
Other than the story of the smoky god, no. But from what I understand, and even from the, I think Helena Blavatsky, that there are some stories mentioned in some of the work she's done, which I have not read a lot of that at all. You know, my focus is on scripture, not what the Illuminists write about or say or declare. I learn about the world and God and what the New World Order are up to through the scriptures, and that's where my focus lies. But I do believe that the Black Sun is metaphor and symbol for what they believe to be the sun that is on the interior of the earth, in the hollow earth. And whether this is true or not, I have no idea, but supposedly there is a internal sun that gives light to those that live on the inside, and that feeds them vitamin D and stuff like that, like the sun on the outside of the earth that, you know, circuits above the surface of the earth, that they call this the smoky god. And the story of the Norwegian fisherman, I forget his name, but he wrote the smoky god, or he told the story, which was written down, and that came to be known as the smoky god. He says and claims to have seen this particular sun, and that, you know, for whatever reason, it is alluded to as the dark sun or the black hole sun, or, you know, this particular smoky god. But other than that, I don't really know more about that.
All right, next question is from Rockwell. Do you have an update on when we will get access to the Thracian text?
No, other than they said it would be sometime at the end of March, which we have already passed. So I will reach out to them again and ask when it will be available in print form. However, I do know without a doubt that we will be representing the Thracian Church here in America and to the English-speaking world, and that they will be selling their products through Sacred Word Publishing, and that we will have, you know, we will be holding and making that available to those that are interested when they do become available. But as of now, I have not heard, but I will reach out again to not only ask about that, but to also invite Todor and the bishop back onto our program. So I'll update as soon as I find out.
Thank you. Next question is from Jay-Z. Where do fallen angels reside?
Everywhere. They are all around us and intermingled all upon the plane of the earth in both visible, physical, and invisible form, and that they are contending as the powers, the principalities, the rulers of darkness and wickedness in high places against the angels of God for influence upon humanity. And that we see even in the Emerald Tablets of Thoth that it describes how they took over the kings of the world, and that they rule over man, having done so that they usurped the authority and the kingship of Adam. Satan usurped the authority of Adam, and so he has temporary reign for what is the 7,000 years of the Second World Age. And so, yeah, they're all around us. They are in physical form. They are the serpent-headed beings spoken about in the Emerald Tablets, especially Tablet number 8, and that they are the seraphic angels, the den of vipers, the seed of the serpent mentioned in the Bible, that, you know, the Kenites, the Canaanites, they are these particular half-cousins of ours, which are warring against us and contending with us as far as the kings and those queens and those that rule through the divine right of kings and that sit on the thrones of the world. And they are the presidents and prime ministers and the leaders of industry, those that print the money, loan it to governments at interest, the IMF, the United Nations, these international agencies which control the affairs of nations. That is the New World Order, and they will rule as the beast kingdom for what will be the reign of the Antichrist. But afterwards, when Christ returns, that kingdom shall be destroyed, and then, you know, he will establish his rule, and the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our Lord.
Thank you. Next question is from Rockwell. I came across a video in a museum about a slave Bible. It only had 200 chapters. Can you please talk about the withholding of information by the seed of the serpent?
A slave Bible? Is that what it said?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Slave Bible.
Yeah. Okay. I'm not familiar with a slave Bible, but absolutely, the seed of the serpent has been at every turn of the way trying to keep the sons of Adam from understanding their inheritance, and also that Christ was prophetically coming to save us and to redeem us and to rectify the fall. And that has been passed down in prophecy, all throughout the generations of the children of Adam, as I show in the two book set, The Testaments of the Patriarchs and the Prophets, and also The Ancient Prophecies of Christ, which is a companion book to those particular testaments. And I take out of much of the extra biblical materials all of these prophecies, which are alluding to and describe and show how the Israelites, the Hebrew people, not only knew about the coming of Christ, but that they understood the Godhead to be a Trinity, and that they worshipped and revered the Father, Yahweh, the I Am That I Am, and also the Son, Yahushua, as Christ and Savior Messiah. And the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, Sophia, wisdom, the Chokmah, as the feminine aspect of the Godhead. And so all of those things are and can be found in the ancient traditions, in the ancient manuscripts, and the ancient stories, the extra biblical books, and if people are interested in those, you can, as I said, look to the Ancient Prophecies of Christ for all of those extracts, and you'll find many, many texts which speak about the coming of Christ as was revealed to the Israelites.
Thank you. Next question is from Melissa Higgins. Does, quote, get out of Babylon, end quote, mean leave America or live not in the flesh?
I think it is more get out of the matrix of the world and the carnal aspects of life and the temptations of life in the flesh, with the call to sin, to indulge in pleasures, the pleasures of this world. That is what God is speaking about when he says come out of Babylon, in my opinion. And that has to do also with the church and the idolatry of it and scientism and the American dream of materialism and, you know, get a good education, get a good job, be a good taxpayer. All of that, because all of that really is an illusion as well. Even the whole thing of focusing on only, as far as, you know, the inheritance and legacy, as far as children and generations and all that, even though that is a beautiful aspect of life and being, that's not the focus of what we are really here to do. What we are really here to do is to understand salvation and eternity through Christ, and to understand why we came into the flesh, our purpose for being here, and the timeline of the beginning and the end as revealed within the gospel, because that's what's real. Eternity is all that matters. Salvation through Christ is all that matters, and that's what we're really here to accomplish with lifetime and with the free will choice, as far as, you know, us all being predestined here to come into the flesh, and that we are to use our free will to really come to knowledge on why it was, how it was that, you know, the temptation to eat from the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil led to humanity being born into flesh, are being incarnated into mortal form, into this world in a fallen state, in a fallen world, all of that, and how all that ties to the story of Adam and Eve, and then the war, you know, the war in heaven, Adam and Eve, the enmity between the seed of the woman, the seed of the serpent, its connections to the harvest, the wheat and the tares, the goat and the sheep, all of that is really why we are here. And so, in my opinion, being called out of Babylon is being called out of the focus and the tie-ups and the distractions and the entertainments of this world and our preoccupation with it, and being able to place our focus on the kingdom, on what Christ said. My kingdom is not of this world. Neither are we of this world. We are vacationing here for this lifetime, what we are caught up in the flesh. But certainly our place is with God in paradise, the home of the righteous, and being restored to our former estate and our original bright nature.
Thank you. Next question is from Carolina Cowboy. Was Cain afraid of pre-Adamites, and is that who Cain had daughters by them?
Cain had daughters by them. I think that, yeah, Cain was more than the pre-Adamites, that he was concerned with the fallen ones, with the devil, with Satan and the rebel angels that were cast out here. Because the pre-Adamites, you know, I don't think he was as much as concerned with them, because they were just servants to the fallen angels. They were, you know, they attempted to make a slave race out of them. But he was concerned with Legion, in my opinion. And he rightfully should have been. But he... It depends on the story as to... Some say that he went east to the land of Nod, and there he became sort of a king, that he built a city, and that it was occupied by the pre-Adamites, and that he intermingled with them, and that he also became king over them, some of them, you know, those that were in the land of Nod. There are other stories which say that both Cain and Abel were born with twin sisters, and that Cain, lusting after his own twin, killed Abel and then took of his own twin sister with him, named Lulawa, and went east after killing Abel and being exiled, that they then went east and as a couple brought the, you know, the Kenites into being. And so it depends on really what story. We don't hear the fullness of it one way or the other, but we do know that Cain propagated, and that the first 10 generations of his bloodline are cited in Genesis chapter 4, and that Adam's genealogy and his 10 generations are cited in Genesis chapter 5, and that there is a distinction between these two people groups. One, you know, that Cain's children, they are the tares, they are the seed of the serpent, and they are the ones that will be judged and condemned at the end of the age. And that Adam's children are the seed of the woman, and that it was through his lineage that Christ would be born. And we see that in Luke chapter 3, verses 30 through 38, I believe, Cain is excluded from that genealogical list, and which shows, you know, that as it says in 1 John chapter 3 verse 12, Cain was of that wicked one. That word of meaning son, child, and descendant, or descendant of, and he was the cockatrice spoken about in Luke chapter 14. And so that's the distinction between these two particular bloodlines, and as far as Cain, who he was afraid of, in my opinion.
Thank you. Next question is from William Dean. Zen, have you seen the research from the YouTube channel The God Culture? They have a series on how Noah divided up the entire world for his sons. They go into the topic that reminded me of you. They go into topics that remind me of you.
I have heard of, and I think I've probably seen a couple videos by The God Culture, but I'm not familiar with what ones and what it was that I saw. I definitely did not see the one that you're talking about. But if you're interested in knowing about how the nations came about, how they were divided, and how they were separated, there's a book that we've released called The Travels of Noah in Europe, which talk about the flood and how the division of the earth came about amongst his children. And it also reveals in great detail the stories of the giants and their connections to the different people groups, and you know, how Ham was the seed of the serpent after the flood, and how the children of the Canaanites and all of that basically went to war against both Shem and Japheth and Nimrod, all of that. And that particular book is a translation from, I believe it was 1602, and it was a ancient translation of one of the books of Berossus, which Berossus was the Chaldean historian who wrote the antediluvian legends for Alexander the Great. He was asked by Alexander to write down these ancient narratives. And most of his dialogues, most of his writings have since disappeared. And the only thing that we have left of them are the quotations in other historical accounts from different individuals, like Polyhistor and others, Pliny and others. But that particular book is one that is based on the writings of Berossus, and it gives you great detail in the stories of Noah and the divisions of how the even the modern nations, who they stem from, who they came from, who conquered what lands, who controlled. I mean, it's an incredible detailed account of the after the flood of Noah's day, and how the different nations, the table of nations, broke up and came to be what they are now.
Thank you. Next question is from G.T. Bradford. Do you believe Nimrod and Gilgamesh are the same? Is the same person? I've heard this, but can't see why. Thank you.
No, I don't believe that. In my opinion, Nimrod is a human, and he was born of the line of Ham. He was the son of Cush. And Cush had stolen the garments of power from, Ham had stolen the garments of power from Adam and given them to Cush, and Cush gave them on to Nimrod. But Nimrod was of the line of Ham. And Gilgamesh, it was a giant. He was part, his father was an angel, and his mother earthly, and so he was partially divine, and he was a six-fingered, six-toed giant. And you can see that he is mentioned in the Book of Giants that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls as being one of those found amongst the giants that were given vision of their destruction, and that had gone to Enoch for interpretation on how they could survive the flood. And basically Enoch told them that your destruction is coming, and that God has numbered your days, and that the giants were disturbed by these dreams that they kept having of the trees. And the metaphor was that they were these giant trees, and that they kept being chopped down. And so, you know how haughty and proud and mighty they thought they were, and that they were above retribution and consequence, and that, you know, God could not do anything to them. Well, he humbled them and gave them dream, and then revealed to Enoch how he was bringing essentially their slaughter and destruction with not only the flood, but also with the war and the battles that the angels waged against them. And all of that is described in the Book of Enoch. But again, the Book of the Giants confirms that Gilgamesh was a giant. And in the Sumerian narrative, we see that he went in search of immortality because he was different. His father was an angel, and so he was partially a demigod, and he did not want to die, and so he went in search of immortality. But you know, essentially he was judged, brought to death, but because he had no part in salvation, he became one of the demonic spirits that roam here upon the earth. And so Nimrod and Gilgamesh, in my opinion, are completely different.
Thank you. Next question is from the Firmament File. What's this about some Nephilim escaping Tartarus? Do you know anything about that?
Nephilim escaping Tartarus? In my opinion, that's not possible. Tartarus cannot be escaped from. And that in Dante's Inferno, he describes how the giants are being held in the lower level of Tartarus, which Tartarus is the lowest level of Sheol. And we see in the scriptures that Jude and Peter make mention of the angels that left their place of habitation and how they were bound in the terror of Tartarus. And so there will be four angels at the end of days that will be released from the river Euphrates. Whether they are from Tartarus, I have no idea. But there's no escaping Tartarus unless God allows them to come forth. And I do believe, though, at the end of days, it says that the giants will be released from their imprisonment within the interior of the earth, and they will come forth from the north, which the North Pole, again, that's where the abysmal chasm is. That's where, the entrance to Sheol is. And it says that the locust army, when the angel, the Antichrist, opens the bottomless pit, that the smoke of the pit rises and that the locust army comes forth from the pit. And so at the end of days, once the church is raptured and brought into the protection of Christ, then the wrath of God to be poured out on the wicked and those not written into the books of life, that this supernatural army will be released to destroy one third of those that remain after the catching away and after the preservation of the church and those that are numbered amongst the righteous. But those that are left behind, they will be dealt with by this supernatural army, and that will be part of the wrath of God being poured out on those not written into the books of life or those that have been blotted out, which being blotted out of the books of life shows again that we have free will and that not only can we be written into the books of life, but that we can also be blotted out of them, depending on whether we, once we're born again, we go forth to sin no more. You have to actually be converted as a believer and to, live up to the commandments and to do in the example of Christ and being a foot washer, a watchman and a watchwoman to the world, that there is choice in every day and a decision to be made in every day that keeps us worthy or not, in my opinion.
Thank you. Next question is from Stephen Drysdale. Can you tell us anything about wormwood?
Yeah, in my opinion, wormwood is connected to what people believe to be this object or this planet named Nibiru. In my opinion, Nibiru or wormwood is described in the Colburn Bible as this object called the Destroyer, and that God allows the Destroyer to enter into this time-space dimensionality through the windows of heaven whenever he chooses to bring judgment upon the earth and to use this celestial object as part of delving out that punishment. And that in the Colburn Bible, you see numerous references to even like the Exodus and the judgment that was brought upon the Egyptian people during that time, that it has connections to this wormwood, this destroyer. And it is also described in the Colburn Bible as having connection to the end of days. And so that, in my opinion, is what wormwood is, and that part again, of the judgment against the wicked and those not written into the books of life have to do with the stars coming crashing to the earth. And that will be part, again, of the judgment and the what will lead to there being a new heaven and a new earth. And all of that takes place with the second coming of Christ and before what is the descent of New Jerusalem for the millennial age, that the earth and the heavens will be destroyed, and that the seven, you know, the seals which describe the sun being darkened, the moon turning blood red, and the stars coming crashing to the earth, that is all part of the wrath of God being poured out on the wicked. And one can learn more about this and find great detail of it, again, in the Great Commission 3, the End Time Apocalypses.
Thank you. Next question is from Jesus for Life. Is there a connection between the word arch and ark in the Bible? Noah's ark is an arch shape. The rainbow he has set was an arch. And the Hoover Dam will be destroyed and is an arch holding floodwaters.
I'm not positive. I think there probably is a connection, because I think that the CH was transliterated into being the K, but I'm no linguist, and so I don't know, you know, as to whether that is absolutely true one way or the other. But I feel like, you know, there is connection, but I can't say for sure.
Thank you. Next question is from GT Bradford. In the movie, quote, They Live, do you think the glasses worn have a truth behind it?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because in this world now, there are those of us that are awakened and that have the eyes to see, the ears to hear, and a mind to understand. And the majority simply don't. And in the same manner as in that movie, Live, Roddy Piper and others that, you know, had the eyes to see, they were able to perceive and to understand the matrix of this world in different manner. And they were able to discern and to decipher the messages and the true meanings of what they were contending and what they were dealing with. And in that movie, we see that there was this alien species, sort of like the a reptilian presence, which, you know, in the truth of this world, we have the seed of the serpent, the den of vipers, contending against us as the children of Cain, the sons of Belial. And that's why God, Christ said of them, you know, that, the dragon, the ancient dragon, that old serpent who deceiveth the whole world, that Cain was of the wicked one. And he says in Matthew 13 that the wicked one is the enemy. The enemy is, in the parable of the sower, he that snuck into the garden, that beguiled Eve, impregnated her with Cain, and that produced the tares. The tares, as it says further in Matthew 13, are the children of the enemy, and the enemy is the devil. And so the tares are the children of the devil. And so what we see being depicted in that movie, They Live, is what we are dealing with in world, even though nobody understands and nobody can make sense of it. And we see this also depicted in the trilogy of the Matrix movies, how some are unplugged and can then make sense of what is real and what isn't. And yeah, it's absolutely that way now.
Thank you. Next question is from Mary Monica. Zen, who, in your opinion, wrote Revelation and when?
I do believe that the vision was given to John the Revelator, who was exiled to the Isle of Patmos. And in fact, we will be going into a story called The Acts of John and how they tried to kill him by poisoning him initially. And when God wouldn't allow them to kill him, they basically exiled him to Patmos to die, you know, of starvation. And there he received the revelation. Now, there's two stories. One is that John wrote the revelation and shared it as he saw it. And then there's another that tells us in the, and I share this in the Great Commission 1, that John the Revelator had an apprentice named John as well, and that he was his scribe. And some traditions, some stories say that it was this John that wrote down the vision of Revelation as given to John the Revelator on the island of Patmos. Either way, it came to us from the vision that John received directly, and that he then either penned it himself or he revealed it to his scribe and he penned it. And this was done many times. I mean, like you see in the book of the Ascension of Isaiah, that Isaiah having a vision, that his vision was also scribed down in similarity by one of those that were, you know, his apprentice or his follower that helped him. And that this was done many times by, you know, that many of the books, what people believe to be pseudepigrapha, that they were dictated and related in such manner when people were having vision. And that describing their vision, that it was scribed down in that manner. And so, but in my opinion, we can see that those particular texts being prophetic, that they were inspired by God. And so you see again the fingerprints of God and the divine inspiration upon them, and that understanding that one can trust them and what is revealed within them, in my opinion.
Thank you. It is 11 o'clock p.m. So, Zen, can you please close us out in prayer?
Absolutely. Father God, we humble ourselves before you again in thanksgiving for this evening and for this chance to come together in congregation in this manner to share the testimony of Christ. And why it was necessary for him to come into the flesh in order to redeem us and to restore us to faith and to our original bright-natured immortal being and to return us to our first estate. And the story of the promise of his coming and the manifestation, the incarnation, and the prophetic fulfillment, completion, of his entering into this world and into this age, and of his going forth, he said, I go now before you to prepare a place for you, that in my Father's house are many mansions, but that as I go, I will come and I will return again, and that he's coming to redeem us at the end of the age, because he said that unless the days be shortened, there should be no flesh left. And so my prayer, Father, before you is that you bless all those that are listening, that are seeking, that are knocking, and that desire to understand the revelation of your word, that want to have close relationship with you, to have intimate knowledge of who you are and how to understand you as creator, and that we being made in your image are near and dear to your heart. And so, Father, just bless all those that are listening to this broadcast, that will listen to the archives. Help us all to discern the truth, to really understand what is, and to go forth and to share that as watchmen, watchwomen, and foot washers unto humanity, so that others can prepare themselves for those things that are coming. Because you said that what is coming will cause men's heart to fail them. And we know that the Antichrist, the extraterrestrials creating us, and that whole lie being pushed forth by the Copernican heliocentric Darwinian cosmology, that the truth will wipe all that, destroy it in an instant. And so that's what I wish for people, that they come to discernment and come to knowledge in the manner that I have, so that they can understand and see through the facade of the lies that are coming down the pipe as strong delusion, and that they are able to help others to discern the same. That most importantly, we bring others to remembrance on what this life is really about, and why it is that we need to focus on the kingdom, and why it is that we need to study the scriptures to show ourselves approved, so that we can be ready and worthy when you return for us. In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I pray and give thanks. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Zen, and thank you for all those who are listening with us. And thank you for those who have sent in your questions. If we did not get to your question tonight, please feel free to email us at sacredwordpublishingllc@gmail.com with subject line questions for Zen, and we'll make sure that it's on a future episode. And with that, thank you so much, and shalom.
God bless all.